So hello, and thank you very much for joining us, and thank you very much for the invitation. It's a great pleasure to discuss the management of cardiac arrest and with the focus on hypothermic patients. First of all, I would like to say that I have no conflict of interest with regard to this topic. And before we go deeper into the management of hypothermic patients, we should define what accidental hypothermia is. So in contrast to therapeutic hypothermia, accidental hypothermia is something which happens involuntarily to the patient and is defined by a drop of the core temperature below 35 degrees Celsius. Because of inconsistent diagnosis of hypothermia, only a few countries have been able to report the cases of primary hypothermic cardiac arrest. Primary hypothermic cardiac arrest means that cardiac arrest happens due to hypothermia, while secondary cardiac arrest means that hypothermia is induced due to trauma, intoxication, or illnesses. And we are focusing mainly on primary hypothermia in this lecture. So why is hypothermia dangerous for human beings? Well, fact is that Homo sapiens basically evolved in Africa and came out of Africa 60, 70,000 years ago, but he is not adapted to living in cold. If you consider that 10,000 BC, the first modern humans to walk on the British Islands looked like this gentleman below, you can imagine that they have not been able to adapt to the cold. They had tainted skin, blue eyes, and curled hair, and of course had to protect themselves against the cold with clothes and the respective behavior. So before we go into cardiac arrest, we should also be able to understand what the lower limits of survival core temperatures are. And this is the case with the lowest ever survived core temperature from accidental hypothermia in a two-year-old boy who was found unwitnessed asystolic cardiac arrest, underwent extracorporeal life support rewarming after CPR, and had neurologically intact recovery even 5 years after this event. But if we consider what the lowest survivable core temperature is in the whole history, then we have to look further back into the 50s and 60s of the last century, and 4.2 degrees Celsius was the lowest temperature with good neurological outcome ever survived in a case series of cardiac and neurosurgical operations. Why can hypothermia be survived so long and so deep? Well, the point is that the lower the core temperature falls, the less oxygen is consumed in the body. That means instead of 5 minutes of cardiac arrest, which can be survived with normal thermia, people can survive for 20 or even 30 or even many more minutes, a state of no, or even what that means cardiac arrest or low blood flow state, which is basically CPR. And this case of 9 hours of CPR and following extracorporeal life support rewarming is the case with the longest no and low blood flow state with good neurological outcome ever reported so far. When is this possible? When can such a situation be survived? Well, basically, CPR has to be of high quality. It should be continuous, but in certain circumstances, it has also to be intermittent, for instance, with difficult transportations. And epinephrine when hypothermic patients should be withheld, and above 30 degrees Celsius, it should be, the periods of administration should be prolonged, and only up to 3 defibrillation should be applied below 30 degrees Celsius. And of course, very importantly, extracorporeal life support is the standard treatment in these patients. Importantly, patients can only survive cardiac arrest with hypothermia if hypothermia develops before hypoxia sets in. That means hypothermia will protect the body, and if cardiac arrest develops thereafter, the oxygen consumption is so low that hypoxia develops very slowly and does not damage the brain and the heart, which are the most oxygen-dependent organs in our body. Before we come to the algorithm, I would like to show you two systematic reviews, which are very important. The first one is about the rescue collapse, which basically in hypothermia means witnessed cardiac arrest in a patient who had spontaneous circulation, but because of ongoing cooling, had witnessed cardiac arrest. And in these cases, it's important to know that hypothermic cardiac arrest only develops below 30 degrees and in young and healthy adults. The chances of survival are very high, and most of these patients had good neurological outcome. Even more interestingly is this second systematic review, which basically looked at unwitnessed hypothermic cardiac arrest patients. And there were more than 200 patients who were basically assessed, and more than a quarter survived, and most of them had neurological intact outcome. Importantly, most of these survivors had a systole, and all of them were unwitnessed with their cardiac arrest. If you consider the normothermic cardiac arrest algorithm and qualification parameters for extracorporeal life support resuscitation, a systole and unwitnessed cardiac arrest are exclusion criteria, but this is not true for hypothermic cardiac arrest. Recently, this review was published in the ESAIC journal, and basically it stated that there are many instances which in normothermic cardiac arrest are contraindications for ECLS rewarming, but with hypothermic cardiac arrest, this is not true. We discussed already a systole and unwitnessed cardiac arrest. There are even more parameters where which should not preclude from ECLS rewarming in hypothermic cardiac arrest. So let's come to the hypothermia algorithm, therapy algorithm, which has recently been published. Just remind yourself that there are three branches of in the algorithm. So first, there's the cold patient who is conscious. So we start on the top, assess the core temperature. If you do not have a temperature measurement, touch the patient on his trunk. He should be cold. Then check for vital signs. If they are present, then we move on to the left side. We check for the consciousness level. If the consciousness is not impaired, that means the hypothermia is just mild. The patient can be transported to the next hospital, which is able to treat his illnesses or his injuries. And there the patient should be rewarmed passively. That means from shivering, also actively externally with warm, forced warm blankets and some sweet drinks and active movements. Secondly, there is the patient who is unconscious with vital signs still present. That means we are in the middle branch of this algorithm. So let's check the patient again for his state of temperature, then check for vital signs. They are still present, but here the consciousness is impaired. And importantly, we have to check in this case, at this stage of hypothermia, if there are any reasons why a patient is at risk of suffering imminent cardiac arrest due to hypothermia, like these parameters are systolic blood pressure below 90 degrees, cardiocirculatory instability, or core temperature below 32 degrees in elderly and multimorbid, or 30 degrees in young and healthy. If one of these parameters is present, bring the patient to the ECLS center, rewarm the patient actively externally, and if he arrests, he is already in the right center and ECLS should be started immediately. Then there is the cold patient without signs of life. So basically, again, you could be in the middle branch, but this time you witness a cardiac arrest, a rescue collapse in this hypothermic patient. Then, of course, you start CPR immediately, or already at the beginning, you check for vital signs. You know that the patient is cold. He has no vital signs. You check if there are any reasons why CPR should not be started. If there are no reasons, start CPR according to the hypothermia algorithm, bring the patient to an ECLS center, check if there are good chances of survival with the HOPE score, which is the best validated score for the prognosis of outcome in hypothermic cardiac arrest patients who are planned to undergo ECLS rewarming. If the score is above 10, rewarm the patient. Be reminded that the HOPE score is a six-parameter algorithm. It's better to use the HOPE score than the old serum potassium and core temperature based outcome prediction. Finally, I would like to talk about the intermittent CPR algorithm, which is also part of the new ESERC guidelines. So of course, if the patient is hypothermic and cardiac arrest has been checked, this patient should be put under mechanical CPR, but if it is not available, you have to do manual CPR. And if you have to interrupt CPR because of transportation issues, the patient should be cold than 10 to 8 degrees Celsius, or if you cannot measure temperature, he should have an unequivocal hypothermic cardiac arrest history. And then you can, if you have to interrupt CPR for transport reasons, perform 5 minutes of CPR to load the patient with oxygen and then transport him without chest compressions for up to 5 minutes. Again, if the patient is very cold, you can even consider after 5 minutes of loading him to interrupt CPR for up to 10 minutes. In conclusions, hypothermic cardiac arrest patients have excellent chance of outcome if hypothermia ensues before hypoxia. And also unwitnessed asystolic hypothermic cardiac arrest patients have good chances of ECLS rewarming outcome after being rewarmed in comparison to normothermic cardiac arrest patients. Standard CPR is very important. Consider intermittent CPR, no drugs below 30 degrees, longer periods above 30 degrees, no defibrillate, only up to 3 defibrillations below 30 degrees Celsius, ECLS center prognostication with HOPE score. Finally, if you want to know more, look at this book and look at this special issue on accidental and environmental hypothermia. This is all. If you have any questions, I'm very happy to reply, and thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, so thank you very much, Peter, for this, again, excellent and very clear presentation. We are on perfect time. Probably we have to move the whole discussion at the end, but just before going to the third speaker, just very brief question, then we might rediscuss at the end. Just some practical consideration. Can you just remember or tell us something more about the HOPE score, so how to predict a patient's in which ECLS will be the best choice?
Okay, so yes, of course. So the HOPE score is a six-parameter algorithm, which basically can be assessed in the hospital in comparison to the old potassium algorithm, which basically for accidental hypothermia said that if potassium is lower than 12, you should start with ECLS rewarming. The HOPE score offers higher, better prognostication of survivors and excludes some non-survivors. So in contrast to the potassium triage, which was used until 2018 when the HOPE score was published, and then there was a validation published 1 year later in 2019, both in resuscitation, including almost 400 patients. So both studies, the HOPE score also includes the temperature and also includes sex, and also includes the duration of CPR, and also, for instance, if the patient has been asphyctic, suffered as asphyctic or non-asphyctic cardiac arrest. So in combination, the HOPE score is certainly a further development, a refinement of the potassium triage. And if you look at the data so far, then from out of 100 patients which would be rewarmed with potassium, 30% less patients are rewarmed according to the HOPE score. So the ECLS resources are saved. And so fatal or let's say unnecessary rewarming can be avoided. So we really recommend to use the HOPE score. It can also be found online. If you just Google for hypothermia score, you can find it and then you can use it online. And data can also be inserted and then we'll go into a database and help us to provide additional, let's say, developments and refinements for the HOPE score.